So, excellent. Well, a couple things before we begin the worship. One, this is Memorial Day. While it is the unofficial beginning to summer, and hopefully people, especially compared to last year, might be able to start gathering safely with friends or family for cookouts, whatever it might be, with vaccines being out there now. We don't have this day just to have a big party. We have this day to remember those who have served this country and lost their lives in that service. And so during our prayer time, we will offer a special prayer in honor of those people who lost their lives. And also, while we remember that, we also look forward to the day and we pray in which there is no more war. There is no more violence. There are no militaries because there are no divisions between us. There is simply God's peace and God's love that is known for all. That when we look at one another, we don't see an American, we don't see someone from England or from China or anything like that. What we see is a brother or sister or sibling in Christ. And so while we honor those who have lost their lives, we look forward to the day in which there is no more war at all. Also, it's Trinity Sunday. So as you see, the image is the stained glass. And if you could see me in your little window, hopefully you see the stained glass again. Trinity Sunday is a day in the church year that always follows Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost is the season of the church. It's the shortest. It's only one Sunday in which we celebrate the giving of the Spirit. Now that the Spirit has been given, the church has a day within the liturgical year in which we celebrate a doctrine of the church. We celebrate the Trinity, the three primary ways in which we experience God, in which we can name God, in which we believe God acts on behalf of God's creation. And that comes to us through God the Father or Creator, God the Son or the Redeemer, and God the Spirit or Sustainer. Three persons, one being. We are strongly monotheistic, one God, but God is three parts or three persons, or I like to say three ways in which God primarily acts on behalf of the creation. It's also good to remember the best way I have found to describe God or to explain who God is, what God is always through relationship. To understand God is to understand God's relationship with God's creation. And I think that is something the Trinity points to. Three ways in which God relates to the creation. That God isn't so much separate off somewhere else, but God is intimately entwined in the creation, in relationship, and the Trinity points to that. Also, lastly, before we begin, the scripture that we get with Trinity Sunday is the most famous scripture verse, or it contains the most famous scripture verse of John 3:16. So let us begin. We have the Clemens family, minus daughter Sabi, who's away at school, but take it away, Jim, Ruby, and Annika.
Good morning, Holy Trinity, and welcome to worship. We're welcoming you. We're the Clemens. We live over in Madbury, New Hampshire, and we're happy to welcome you to worship today. You see only three of us today. We have another daughter. Her name is Isabella. She's also goes by Sabby. She's down at boarding school in Massachusetts right now, so she's not able to welcome us. But I'm Jim. This is Ruby.
Hello.
And then this is Annika here, and we're all happy to welcome you to worship. A little bit of background on us. We've been in the area for almost 3 years now, and we enjoy worshiping at Holy Trinity, especially when Holy Trinity actually is in person, of course. But so we're looking forward to getting back to being in person. Hopefully everything will be all safe and people will be happy with that situation. But we've been here a little less than 3 years. We came from California, where we attended a church called St. Paul's, some of us for about 20 years there. So we were quite there quite a while. but we're happy to be here now. Another interesting thing is that Pastor Tim and I almost shared a history going way back, which is that he and I both attended the same church in Wheaton, Illinois, when we were young spry kids. Unfortunately, we weren't there at the same time, though. I'll leave it to you to guess who's older, Pastor Tim or myself. But yeah, we did attend the same church there at different times, in Wheaton, Illinois. Anyway, we won't go on anymore. We'll just say welcome from the Clemens, and we hope to see you soon in in-person worship.
Welcome to worship. Bye.
Thank you, Clemens family, and that is right, Jim and I, Holy Cross Lutheran Church in Wheaton, Illinois. We did not overlap. I think Jim's family left when my family came, but the same pastor was there, Pastor George Rinke, if I remember correctly. Jim, you could type in chat if that is correct, or my parents, obviously, were there at the time, because that's how I went to church. I believe it was Pastor George who was the pastor that we both had for a short period of time. And there is a chat from him. Let's see what he says. And Jim says, correct. So thank you. And Jim, I would like to, this is just a fun fact. He is also a physics professor at UNH and is gonna be traveling to launch some rockets this summer to study the Earth's, I think, exosphere, one of the outer layers of the stratosphere. So Jim, thanks for your work as discovering more and more about God's creation. And another chat, we'll see if the ionosphere. See, when I taught seventh grade science and fifth grade history, that was more in depth than what we got into, the ionosphere. So thank you, Jim, for that. We continue with our worship. It is Trinity Sunday. You can't have Trinity Sunday without singing Holy, Holy, Holy. So thank you for the people that came and sang that for us. Join in at home if you would like. Here we go. Service with confession and forgiveness. Now, you notice in the past, over the season of Easter, we did a Thanksgiving for baptism. It's more celebratory in nature to do as we are celebrating the risen Christ. But now that we enter into ordinary time or time after Pentecost, we return to a confession and forgiveness, a naming of who we are and how we need God's forgiveness on a weekly, daily basis, but we do it every week now. So we switch from Thanksgiving for baptism to confession and forgiveness. So blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, together let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Let all God's people say, Amen. Amen. We turn it over to the Clemens and Annika for the first reading.
First reading, Romans 8, 12, 17. Brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Annika. And we turn to the gospel reading with Jim.
The Gospel reading for May 30th, 2021, John 3, verses 1 through 17. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can anyone enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished. I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it. But you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Here ends the reading.
Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you, Jim. All right, we're going to start off with if people want to use the chat feature. Does anyone know where this image is from and who it is? If you want to chat that in, or even if it's easy, take yourself off mute and we'll see if somebody can say it. It's a very popular TV show. It's not on the air anymore. I'm looking at the Hollister to see if they know. I wouldn't be surprised if they have seen it. Anyone? I'll be like you.
Matthew from Downton Abbey.
Oh, Julie Kath pulls it out. Did you Google that real quick, Julie? It is a bonus question. Do you know what is happening in this scene that this is taken from? And just in case people didn't hear Julie Kath, Will Wesley typed it in. It is a scene from Downton, the TV show Downton Abbey, PBS masterpiece. The name of the character is Matthew Crawley. Does anybody know what's going on in that scene?
You guys go.
I was going to show it to you, but I couldn't find a video clip of it to make it available. So here's what it is. And this is somebody has it. Let's see. Drafted. Dennis Berg, it's a good guess. It is. It does have something similar to do. It's not Matthew being drafted into the war. I'm going to set the scene for it and tell you what's going on. I'm going to take you off sharing now. I thought I was going to take you off sharing. Give me just a second. There we go. I'm going to take you off sharing so I can see you all. I'm going to preach this way again. It is from Downton Abbey. That is Matthew Crawley. Now, here's the premise of Downton Abbey. It is a show takes place in the early 20th century, immediately after World War I, about an English manor, an English estate in the hills of England, outside of London. And it centers on Lord and Lady Grantham. And they need to pass on their estate to their heir, to who's going to come next. The dilemma is Lord and Lady Grantham only have daughters, and they have three daughters. And according to the inheritance laws, they can't pass on their inheritance to a daughter. It must go to a male. And so there have been close members of the family, cousins, who are supposed to be those people that are supposed to inherit the manor. And one of the daughters, Mary, is supposed to marry one of them, so it kind of stays in the family. The problem is the show opens, so I'm not giving anything away because this has to do with the first episode of the first season, and it really sets the stage for the rest of the series. That gentleman, and actually the two next in line to inherit the estate, are on the Titanic, and it sinks and they die. So now they don't know who is going to inherit the estate after Lord Grantham. And so a search occurs to find the closest male heir to inherit the estate. And it is that gentleman, Matthew Crawley. The problem is nobody really knows Matthew. And Matthew has no interest in inheriting the estate. And what you see in that image was Matthew at breakfast. It's the way the first episode of the first season ends. He's at breakfast with his mother. The post comes in and he says it's a letter from Lord Grantham. And his mother says, what does he want? Matthew opens the letter, reads it, and looks at his mom and says, Lord Grantham wants to change our lives. Lord Grantham wants to change our lives, because what this letter is telling him, he is now the heir to the Downton Abbey estate. And now all of these responsibilities and privileges, whether he wants them or not, are his. And so really the rest of the first season is dealing with that aspect of it. Now Matthew could react to this in a couple different ways. He could be excited about it, right? He could say, are you kidding? I won the lottery. I now get to be Lord of Downton Abbey with everything that comes with it. Or he could be thinking, I want nothing to do with it. I have my life. I have my career. I have my home. I have my friends. I have everything already working out according to my plan. And I wish this letter from Lord Grantham never came to me. What is his reaction, do you think? Do you think there's that excitement over it, or do you think there's more of a resentment about it? He has more of a resentment about it. He has his life. He doesn't want to be the heir to Downton Abbey. Just leave me alone. Let me see you from a distance and let me continue on my way. I use this example of Downton, and if you haven't seen it, I would highly recommend watching that show. It's just fun. But I use that example because of the reading from Romans when it talks about we are heirs of God or heirs with Christ. We have been chosen to be part of this family with all the responsibilities and privileges that come with it. And we could react like Matthew, and most likely we do. We'd rather keep it as a distance, knowing we're somehow connected to it, but it doesn't really impact our life, right? But in reality, we get a, I don't want to say we get a letter from God, but we get this calling from God in our lives that says God wants to change your life. And we are called out of one life and into another. And more times than not, we can be resistant to it because we like the way we have things, don't we? We have it all figured out. We have, you know, our career, our life, our family, our friends, our, you know, we know what we do on Monday morning. We know what we, right? We found this, you know, homeostasis line that's very predictable, and we seek that out. And what God does is come in and turns that upside down and pulls us out of it and gives us this new life with all the privileges and responsibilities that go along with it. And I think this is where it kind of brings in this gospel lesson. Nicodemus, a Pharisee, is trying to figure out what that means because he has his own life, doesn't he? He's a leader of the Pharisees. He thinks he understands how things are supposed to work, but he's getting this inkling from Jesus and from Jesus's followers that there's more to it, that it's different than what he thought he understood. And so he comes to Jesus and is seeking clarification. And he does it at night because he doesn't want to be discovered or known about asking these questions. Because certain questions shouldn't be asked, right? You don't disrupt the apple cart. Just go with the flow because we've already figured out how things work. And we don't want to be disrupted in that. Yet I think a life of faith is one of disruption at some level, is one in which we hear God's call to our life and it is said, we know, think about what you think you know. And I want you to reconsider everything. And in reality, it's better than what we could have imagined. Now, this is where the analogy with Downton Abbey falls apart. Because if this analogy fully carries its way through, when Matthew and his mom come after receiving the letter to visit Downton Abbey that first time, and this is what happens in season 1, episode 2, ideally, the reaction is one of, hey, here's the new heir. Here's the person that's going to come and take everything over and lead us into the future. In reality, what do you think Lord Grantham's 3 daughters and the staff and everybody else is really thinking about when Matthew and his mom walk into Downton Abbey the first time? Who is this guy? Why is he here? He's not one of us. He's simply a lawyer from the city, and he's not worthy to inherit all of this. The truth is, and like I said, this is where it breaks down. When we work to understand what it means to have this inheritance placed on our life, this calling, God is not one saying, "Who do you think you are to come and claim your place at God's table?" The reality is God is welcoming us in to say, "Yes, I am glad you are here. You are mine. You didn't pick me, I picked you. Now part of your job, part of the responsibility that you get to do is go out and tell others, I have picked them as well." That letter that says, "Lord Grantham wants to change your life," we scratch out "Lord Grantham" and we put in "God." And we go out and it's like we're delivering letters from God to people, proclaiming God's love for the creation and saying, "God wants to change your life. God wants to disrupt your apple cart into something that is better than what we could have ever imagined." That's the good news. That's what God has come to do, right? It can be hard. That's the law aspect, because we're playing by different quote unquote rules, and it's better than we could have ever imagined. So my hope, my prayer for all of us this week is, as you go out, may you know, may you experience this new life in Christ. May your old world that we cling to in unhealthy ways be disrupted. And may you somehow see that letter that is written to you that says God wants to change your life. And may you see what that new life in Christ looks like as an heir of Christ. Amen. I'm going to share my screen again as we continue on. This time with the offering, as always, thank you for all the ways you have continually given to Holy Trinity, not just through the pandemic, but over the years and in the years to come. We've been fortunate to really be doing pretty well this year and actually throughout the pandemic. So thank you for the continual support of the ministries and the work that goes on here. It makes a difference. And as always, there's many ways to give: your Alexio app, our website, text to give, or just drop a check in the mail or drop it off the next time you are driving by or need to stop in for whatever reason. So for prayers of the people, we will have a video like we've done before that you can watch and chat in your prayers. But like I said at the beginning of worship, it is Memorial Day. And we want to honor that day and look forward to the day in which there is no more war and there is no more death caused by war. And so I just want to begin this prayer time with a prayer specifically for that, and then we'll move into our normal prayer time. You can see the prayer on your screen. So please pray with me. Almighty God, you are our strength and our shield. We give you thanks for the men and women of our armed forces, past and present, and especially for those who have died while serving. May their sacrifices serve the cause of peace, and may our nation be ever grateful for their service. With your wisdom and strength, guide our military's leaders and give to all people a desire for justice and peace. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with a video about the Trinity. So as it plays, please use the chat feature to type in your prayers. Thank you.
Sinner. You see, Jesus, he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And he said, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I heard that Jesus, he was up on the mountaintop. Oh, Lord, 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 Lord Jesus. He was a mighty good man. Yes, he was. Jesus, oh, Jesus. Jesus so loved the world tonight. Oh, yes, he do. Yeah, he fed 5,000 a day and 4,000 feed us. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Hey, you know, every time you pray to Jesus, every time you pray to Jesus, it brings you hope.
Together, let us pray. Lord, you call us heirs to Christ, not because of anything that we have done or accomplished, simply because we are part of your creation and you love us. Open our hearts and minds to new ways of understanding, experiencing, and living out your love. So help us to hear your voice to call us out of our old life and into a new life with you. We have prayers in which we've typed out here for Joe's mom and her last radiation treatment. Let her remain free from cancer. For Dennis' cousins, Brad, who has entered hospice, is not expected to last the week. Welcome him into your arms when that time comes. For those families who have lost ones recently to gun violence, as we continually hear more news about mass shootings. Again, we thank you for the service people of our country and remember those who have lost their lives. for Maharani's cousin Adi at the end of stage cancer. And we pray that your Holy Spirit guides us and protects us as we strive to live your life. All these things we ask for in your name. Amen. Amen. If you have your communion, take it out now. Go ahead, a good time to peel back the cellophane layer to reveal the wafer if you're using one of these cups, and then also to peel back the foil to reveal the grape juice. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It's right.
Give our thanks and praise.
So in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave thanks, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." Again, at supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in the remembrance of me." Together with the Clemens family, let us pray the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Body of Christ, given for you. Blood of Christ, shed for you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. All right, we got several announcements to make our way through this morning. Our summer worship schedule. Bob and Judy, I want to make sure you are sitting next to me that you can see this right now. Our final Zoom worship service will be next Sunday. Just so you're aware of that, because on the 13th, we are moving to our summer schedule. One worship service at 9:30. It will be outside under the tent and that surrounding area. So bring a chair with you. If you need a chair, one will be provided for you. You don't need to sign up. Just show up. Masks will be optional outside. Hopefully, for vaccinated people. But we know that some people will choose to continue wearing a mask because for any number of reasons. It doesn't matter what those are. So if you feel the need to wear a mask, wear the mask. If you have been vaccinated and you are comfortable taking your mask off, you may take your mask off. Also knowing in inclement weather, we will move indoors, heat, rain, humidity. And when we move indoors, then all masks are required of everybody. And on those Sundays that we need to move indoors, because the amount of people that generally have attended summer worship services, we feel you do not need to sign up ahead of time to come, that we will still be able to maintain appropriate spacing when we are inside, and we can provide that safe environment if we require everybody to wear a mask as well. So please join us. Also, if you have been a regular attender through Zoom, there will still be online options for you. We will always have an online option, even after the pandemic is over, whether we are outside or inside. It will be streamed on YouTube live at the time. You can find that link on our website, htelc.com. So Bergs, Keith, my parents, whoever it might be, Wesley's, we will miss seeing your face every day or every Sunday as we have and seeing those prayers that you offer. We hope you can still join us through YouTube and that worship service. Also know Wednesday evening worships will begin again starting June 16th outdoors underneath the tent at 6 p.m. They will they will have communion at that time as well. Also on June 13th is our semi-annual meeting. So fortunately, there's nothing big going on that we need to hold votes for, that kind of stuff, but it is an update. You'll hear where we are financially. And Christina Dolcino, the council president, myself, will just do a brief summary of where we are, but that will be immediately following the service on June 13th. Also, one more thing, I don't think this announcement is in there. For those services starting June 13th, we want to start doing fellowship again, providing coffee and treats. But we want to change up a little bit of the way we do it. Normally, when we do fellowship, there's generally one person or one family that's responsible for setup, takedown, bringing the food, everything. We understand with it now being outside, that's a bit more work. We want to ease that burden. So we'd like to have a couple people or a couple families be involved in the setup and distribution of food and coffee, making all that. And we don't want it to be reliant on them to have to bring the food. So starting this week, there will be signups through Tidings and available on our website in which you can sign up to do fellowship and you could sign up to bring cookies or some other kind of treat for Sunday morning. It'd be great to have 5-6 people bring something in every Sunday. And so you can sign up for that as well. So ease the burden on that one person who might feel responsible for it all. Let's spread it out, make it a little bit easier and involve more people. So look for that coming up starting Sunday, June 13th. Also starting on Wednesdays, but not till summer, July 14th through the August 11th, our VBS is gonna have a different form. It's not gonna be 5 nights over 1 week, but 5 nights over 5 weeks. And we're calling it Backyard Wednesdays. Dinner at 5:30, worship at 6 with VBS to follow immediately. And think of it like a backyard barbecue that you would do during the summer. We're going to grill burgers and hot dogs. Church will provide the burgers and hot dogs and a drink. We're going to ask people to provide sides to go with it. We are going to need people to help grill and set up cleanup. We have individuals to help lead each week, but we need to fill that in with other supporting people. So as those dates come closer, please be looking on how you can attend and help participate in the grilling setup cleanup. And this is really designed with everybody in mind, not just for younger kids, but these 5 Wednesdays from 5:30 to 7:30, 7:45, we want everybody to be involved. So come join Backyard Wednesdays is our VBS here at Holy Trinity this summer. It really looks to be a great time. We hope you can join us in it. Also on June 13th, man, there's a lot going on. Graduation Sunday. If you are graduating from high school, from college, a certificate program, you are completing something that we can celebrate. We want to celebrate it with you. Please contact the church so we can celebrate and name that. Camp Calumet is happening. So if you haven't signed up yet, please do. We have a few kids from our church that are going to be attending. If money is an issue, scholarships are available. Money should never prevent somebody from going to camp. Through some anonymous donors, we have a generous scholarship fund, and through our own spending plan, we always set money aside for people to go to Calumet. So sign up, let us know, and we will help pay for your child, grandchild, to go to camp. They will not regret it. Pop-up pantry. Some of our regular packers are going on vacation this summer, so we need some people to help fill in Wednesday mornings from about 7:30 to 8:30, 9 o'clock. If you are willing to help pack and set up bags, please contact Paulette or contact the church office. And along with that, Dover Friendly Kitchen continues to do well. This past week, we had 360 cookies donated. We had eight or so, I don't know if it was eight, but we had plenty of volunteers to package the meals and distribute the meals. But our next time, June 22nd, for Dover Friendly Kitchen, the stalwarts of Bonnie Sanders and Laura Scammon are going to be gone on vacation. We have people to fill in the leading of it. but we need a few more volunteers to help take their place. June 22nd, Dover Friendly Kitchen. You'll see more announcements about it coming up. But if you can help out, distribute food, we'd love to have that help coming up. Birthdays and anniversaries. I don't always say happy birthday, says the most interesting man in the world. But when I do, it's only to legends. So who are the legends we can wish happy birthday to? And anniversaries. A perfect marriage is just two imperfect people who refuse to give up on each other. If you had an anniversary we can celebrate, please type it in now as we sing our sending song. This is my song. Feely says two family celebrations, niece Grace graduating from UNH and her daughter Michaela's niece's bat mitzvah. So congratulations on both of those. Mark Edwards turned 75 on Wednesday. Happy birthday, Mark. And Robert Scammon is celebrating 20 years on Tuesday. Happy birthday to Robert. All right, Clemens family, bring it home for us with our... If I can get there. Here we go.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Clemens family, for hosting worship. Bob and Judy, thank you for being here this morning. Everybody else.
May the Lord.
Hope it was a meaningful worship for you this morning. There we go. Glad you are with us. If you want to stick around for 10 minutes of fellowship, I can put you in breakout rooms. We'll see who remains. Otherwise, hope to see you next week. Have a great day.